Lord Radio and Elbop on the Bay Bridge faded. Trying to find Smiley's house. Thank God we made it. Yo, blunts brought in reach, keeping low through the streets.
Yes, yes. Those sounds you hear are the people under the stairs. Something we've had to do far too often on this show is have our moment of silence and RIP, great double K from People Under the Stairs, San Francisco hip hop group. Artemis, I know you got thoughts on these guys.
Oh, yo, People Under the Stairs, man. Puts, as people like to call them, such a dope group. Been at it for years. I want to say, like, they're one of the groups that a lot of people forget, especially in the DC area. They would sell out shows at like Rock and Roll Hotel or 930 Club and just kill it. One of the last times I got to see them, actually, if I'm not mistaken, they were on stage with a special appearance by Master Ace years ago. You know, yeah. It was just dope to see them all three together, like a group that you'd never think of. If y'all ever get a chance, look up People Under the Stairs. Their catalog is very extensive.
Yes.
Especially with this one. This one has done like a lot of like solo work and has actually gotten into like TV commercials and movies and stuff with what he's been doing. But Double K, man, he was one of those contributing figures in hip hop we should honor. So let's have a moment of silence for Double K, man. Rest in peace, power in paradise. All right, cool. We miss you, good brother.
Peace. Miss you. Well, we are Grande Loq. We are the Grandiloquent Hip Hop Show. Welcome, welcome. I hope you stick around for the whole show. We've got, I think, a really good one tonight. So who are we? We're three lovers of hip hop, creators of hip hop, and we love to talk hip hop straight to the old heads and lovers of great music. I'm your co-host, Ian Taranji. My esteemed co-host, Tia Abner, is joining us this evening.
Yes.
How are you, Tia?
I'm feeling good.
Good, good, good. Great to see you. Great to be with you again.
Yeah.
And of course, we heard from the Grandiloquent one himself, Artemis. Artemis, yo, how are you?
I'm chilling, man. Just like taking it one day at a time, man. Mm-hmm. Also, if y'all don't mind, I would also like to send a rest in peace out to Cicely Tyson, Larry King. Yes. And Dustin Diamond, aka Screech, was Saved by the Bell, man.
Yeah.
2021 is already hitting us hard. So I just want to honor some of the people that we came up on, man. You know, so.
Yes, very much so.
For sure. For sure. We have to do this all too often. It's unfortunate. But, you know, what I think is wonderful about our show is that we're able to give people flowers while they're still here.
Exactly.
Because we talk great hip hop. You know, even though we're old heads, there is still a lot of wonderful, wonderful hip hop and music being made by some real artists. And we try to bring that to you. And then we also go back and get in touch with the albums that made us lovers of hip hop. And tonight is no different. It was my choice on the classic album to review. And just a little preview. I'm going to take you back to the frat parties where, like, I got a feeling that this was every white kid's favorite hip hop record for about 3 years going. Dr. Dre's The Chronic, and then prior to that, our more recent album that we're going to talk is Magnificent Day for an Execution by the great Pharoah Monch. So glad to have new material from him, and you know, we're going to talk that one up. It's got a very different sound, and I dig it. It's not, I guess, for everybody, but I think we're gonna try to pull it apart and see what's really great about it. So, and then prior to all that, I'm gonna have Artemis. You're gonna kind of school us on what's going on with Tracklib and Bob James and all of those discussions. So, why don't you kick it off for us here?
Okay, so now this is going to be a discussion about something that helps out beat makers / producers. So Tracklib scores a deal with Bob James, which is pretty big. Now, some of y'all that don't know what Tracklib is, I'll break it down to you. I'm going to ask you a question, actually. how many producers and beat makers know about sample clearance houses, or do you know the names of them? See, that's where Tracklib comes into play, because I know Sample Oracle's gonna know. She's gonna know. But you're a different breed. You're a different breed. You know what I'm saying? So, like, this is the thing with Tracklib. It's basically like bridging the gap for a lot of producers and beat makers to clear samples that they want to get in order to like put out their product on the market. You know, whenever like they sell a beat to somebody, they buy it, you know, they have the samples cleared. What Tracklib did was they gave you like some pretty good rates of how to go about clearing the sample. So you pay for the sample clearance itself. Like, they put in the categories A, B, and C. C is going to be the lowest, B is mid-range, A is like the top dollar. And the lowest you can like clear a sample for is going to be for $50. Now, it depends on how many seconds you sample whatever record you get. And also, you're not going to get everything you want out of Tracklib. I think you can suggest things for them to like put on their to put in their library of stuff, a catalog from stuff you can sample, but you don't always get everything that you want out of it, but they have a lot of material to sample from. And on top of that, so let's say you clear something for like $50 or so, okay, cool. And it's within like a few seconds range or whatever. There's also on top of that revenue share that comes with it. So a certain percentage is like taken out. The higher the radius of what you sample, or the higher the category, there's going to be a difference in like the revenue share. If anything, I want to say this is like helping out a lot of different artists, and people get like music cleared as far as samples these days. And it's very interesting. It's probably a very good saving grace if you think about it, because Beastie Boys and Dust Brothers, they got over, but they actually kind of like sealed the deal on a lot of other artists trying to get samples cleared, you know. And it's been happening ever since too. But now this is interesting. When I was bringing up this topic, I was trying to remember who was all involved with this. I was like, I know Questlove was involved with it, and I couldn't remember the person's name from Tommy Boy Records, our Sample Oracle, aka Bottle of Information, Tia. She actually reminded me that Tommy Silverman, I got his name right, Tommy Silverman, over Tommy Boys was a part of this too. Now, Tia, you gave an interesting anecdote about this. So tell me what you're telling us, because I thoroughly agree with what you were saying.
Yes. So one of the things I thought was most, I guess, ironic about the situation is that Tom Silverman, who's the founder of Tommy Boy, like you said, is the U.S. partner to Tracklib. So Tracklib is actually headquartered in Sweden, and, you know, obviously has a global reach. But the fact that Tom Silverman, you know, Tommy Boy has had artists like Africa Bambaataa and De La Soul, and sort of pioneered sampling. If you think about Planet Rock and 3 Feet High and Rising, both of those have been really monumental in how they have brought sampling into the forefront. And the fact that Tom Silverman is sort of responsible for this, I guess, this clash between De La Soul, where they're trying to, they were trying to make a deal about their digital streaming rights. So because they're not getting paid off of those digital streaming rights at all, they don't really want people to stream their music. They don't want you to listen to it in that way. So it's just interesting that, you know, Tom Silverman is really a part of this sort of groundbreaking model around sampling and being able to sort of affordably and legally license music. And yet he doesn't want to allow artists that have really contributed to his label being a success to have them own their own rights to their digital streaming. So, I mean, it's interesting to me on that side, for sure.
Yeah. It's I was struck by the deal that Bob James cut with Tracklib. Look, I mean, Bob James, 70s kind of funk jazz, you know, one of the real pioneers of that subgenre. And his songs have been sampled so many times. We were just actually, I have the numbers up here. T and I were just talking beforehand. So his song Nautilus off his album One has been sampled in 348 songs on Who Sampled, which I know we take Who Sampled. We take Who Sampled, you know, with all the grains of salt.
Samples.
Take Me to the Mardi Gras, 447 songs. So, I mean, that's just two of his cuts. I was in a jazz band and we did Westchester Lady, and I dig that jam. You know, just a tremendous musician. Also, University of Michigan claims him, so got nothing but love for Bob James.
I have a bone to pick with Bob James in just one way.
Go ahead.
And I will introduce this sort of, I hate to be the devil's advocate because I always feel like that's such a word now for the new age Karen, right?
It's
like
do it.
Devil's advocate. But however, I never forget when he lost his cool. If anybody remembers a few years ago, when Otis Jackson Jr., aka Madlib, for a Quasimodo album, actually sampled Bob James, and the issue around, I think he actually sampled, used snippets of Nautilus on Spark the Law, I think. Anyway, the whole issue around that, not only was he disgusted with Madlib, he also said something to the effect, I actually had to pull up the quote. So one of the many problems that confront this issue is that they don't know, meaning hip hop artists, don't know how to play good music. And so they resort to borrowing or sampling music, in this case, mine. And this may have been a statement from his lawyer, not directly from him, right? These are words that are quoted in a, you know, a courthouse document, but that doesn't mean that it's his words directly. But of course, in that case, they settled out of court for copyright infringement and damages and everything else, because of course the song then too, he felt like damaged his reputation. And I think it's interesting that years later, I mean, you know, seminal records like, you know, Ghostface, Daytona 500 and Warren G and Nate Dogg's Regulate. I mean, you know, you could think about, there's a song by Bob James in every, you know, classic groups repertoire, from Run DMC to Public Enemy to Tribe to Public, you know, everybody.
Freddie Gibbs, J.R.R. the Damager, Onyx, Grammatic.
Yeah, there you go. I mean, it's renowned groups and artists, and like all acknowledging and recognizing his brilliance. So to me, I don't know if that's a damaging kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. I think that's more so paying homage and saying we recognize and acknowledge that you have, you know, an incredible gift in that we want to continue to do this. So I just think it's interesting now that, you know, he's all for sampling and is fascinated with like, oh, this album making it into the hip hop, you know, his songs making it into Tracklib, into a hip hop repertoire. But what changed,
right.
I wonder.
Right. I mean, look, it's clear that there's a generation of musicians who were kind of put off by their music being sampled in rap and hip hop. And, you know, you're talking about a time, you know, at least in like the 80s and 90s, when there was kind of still a lot of people thought that hip hop was just, you know, they're just scratching some records and talking, and they're not, you know, like really looking down on the art form, not believing that it was an art form that had staying power. And I'm not suggesting that he obviously doesn't think that. I think now he recognizes, I think frankly he recognizes that his avenues of income generation as a musician are going to be through like sample clearances and hip hop more so than, you know, going out there and making another record and selling it. I mean, at this point, who's buying records? And it's, you know, we've talked music industry economics several times on the show. It seems to come up in the context of a lot of different topics and subjects. You know, when I heard about Bob James getting a deal with Tracklib, it sounded to me like a great business opportunity, because an opportunity to get him paid in a more organized fashion, and an opportunity to get his music out to a generation of producers who can use it. And obviously the fact that it's been sampled so many times on so many brilliant, brilliant songs is, I think, testament to the greatness of that music. You know, but I also realized that if were a 70s funk jazz artist and, you know, you're in your, you know, late 60s, early 70s right now, and you're figuring out how to get income coming in. I mean, this is a good opportunity. It kind of reminded me of when we talked about Bob Dylan and, you know, licensing his entire catalog, because that felt very much almost, it's not exactly sample clearinghouse, but I felt like it was clearinghouse for using this Bob Dylan song in a commercial or this Bob Dylan song in a movie. And him not having to worry about it, his people not having to worry about it. He's got paid, somebody else is dealing with it. And, you know, that's kind of like what this Bob James deal reminded me of a little bit. Artemis, you got some wrap up thoughts on this one?
Damn it, you said what I was going to say, man, because when we were talking about this.
I stole all your ideas.
Damn you, look. Okay, first of all. T brought up a good point about rap, like he felt his rap was damaged. But I wondered that, like, do these jazz musicians get together and just talk about this? Like, does Herbie Hancock talk to, like, Bob James? And does, like, Bob James talk to Grover Washington Jr.? And do they all just, like, because these are people that have been sampled heavily in hip hop. Yeah. Do they all have these discussions like, damn, they got me. Oh, damn, they got me. What they take from you, Watermelon Man? Oh, damn it. They got me too. Like, you know, like I think
in some cases they do, I won't belabor the conversation, but there was remember the Arrested Development, I Am Everyday People, where it's like that song used the Bob James sample, then they used Sly Stone's Everyday People, and then they did the remix. And I think, so Sly Stone's publisher and like Bob James were in the middle of trying to figure out how they could sue EMI because, you know, so yeah, they do try to gang up and like, let's both try to figure out our money. But the, you know, bad thing is that this record companies are always going to win when you're suing the record company, not the artist.
Right. I can see that. And I kind of feel like, you know, with this going on, you know, things are dwindling down with like catalogs. And you had a point, and I remember we initially discussed this. I was like, well, it's not exactly the Bob Dylan situation, because now we're talking about sampling and new creations coming out of like somebody's musical catalog. And it's like the same kind of, it's almost the same kind of deal, but not exactly, you know. Because like you gotta look at like retaining of ownership of that music too, you know.
Right,
I feel like
right.
Bob Dylan was like, I don't own it no more, give me my money. Bob James is probably kind of like, you know, I still own it, but I need a piece of that pie. Give me a few crumbs over here, give me some whipped cream over here.
Look, if his songs have been sampled thousands of times, I mean, that's, you know, what are your legal bills like if you've got to hire somebody to clear samples and you know, and you're getting thousands of requests, you know, plus probably policing all of the unrequested samples.
Right.
You know, this seems like it's just like, all right, y'all deal with this and just give me my cut. But yeah.
And
so,
and a better rate too. And in the long run, it's a better rate, and it's just better for artists like all over, I think. However, it might not be the perfect solution of revenue wise. It might not be, because you could clear a sample for X amount, and you might not get a return on what you like cleared it for. You dig what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know. I mean, we would have to do another episode on like how sampling has been changed anyway. Like the whole sampling market, like companies like Producer Loops, Loop Masters, Black Octopus, Prime Loops, all these companies now are creating their own samples now. Yeah. And you're paying a flat fee, you're getting the samples, and it's like royalty free. You can do this. But that's a whole different ball game. And Tracklib is kind of trying to compete with that. You dig what I'm saying? And it's big to get Bob James. But now we talked about another point. And T, you've been making good points about this. That's why you're the sample oracle. You as well, Ian. But T said something very like key. How many people are now going to sample Bob James? Like, how many more people? You know what I'm saying? It's not like it was back when you heard a Keith Murray record or anything, like just off the break, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's a good point. So I don't know. I don't know. I say in the long run, it's a good deal with Tracklib and Bob James, but that question does remain. So
salute to them both. Anything that gets more revenue to artists and creators is a good thing. That's kind of like my overarching view. Artemis, I gotta take your points because I know how our word of the day freestyler can can think on his feet. You know, he doesn't have to plan it out. you can check out Artemis's word of the day freestyles on TikTok.
Yes, you can.
Get him up to 10,000 likes and he will do a TikTok of whatever dance is the number one trending TikTok dance. If you get him up to 10,000 likes on TikTok,
probably won't.
He will do that. He will do the dance. He will do the dance for you.
I don't dance.
A 30 second TikTok. All right. Let's wrap this one up and let's get to fair homage, guys. All right.
All right.
To the matrix, allow me to morph into Morpheus and escape with metaphysical laws so lost and secret. They'll transform in front of your eyes and shape shift while we fight over who the true father of crisis. We're suffering inside of an economical crisis. Children of the soul, the righteous, turning the black.
Ooh, yes, you have just been listening to Pharaoh March, the incredible, the incomparable. We're about to discuss Pharaoh Monch's latest sort of project. I'll call it a project. It's 13, which is a trio that's led by Pharaoh Monch with Marcus Machado on guitar and Daru Jones on drums, which is Jack Black's drummer. I think it's interesting, this album, A Magnificent Day for an Exorcism. It's his first full-length project, Pharaoh's first full-length project since I think the last solo album was PTSD, Post-Traumatic Stress Disorder, which was released in 2014. I think it's always interesting to note, like, Pharaoh Monch has never been really prolific as Artemis, you know, here. He doesn't have that kind of repertoire, despite having 30 years in the game. So you think about the fact he's got 7 albums to his name. I mean, from Organized Confusion, Stress, Equinox is part of Organized Confusion with Prince Poe, who Artemis has also collaborated with. So we'll talk, Artemis, you've got a lot of background in this particular area right now. But, and then of course, he's got several other albums as a soloist, but again, about 7. So all of them, right, just Pharaoh Monch has always been known for sort of lyrical dexterity and really intelligent, complex, top tier lyricism. Magnificent Day for an Exorcism is really this sort of, I think fans were really excited to have Pharaoh return, but it's not really the return that you're hoping for because it was something that listeners, I think for the most part, might have been disappointed with. We'll talk about the Pitchfork review where this album was pretty much dissed and just no one liked it. In the reviewing team there, but it's as much rock music as it is hip hop, right? So it's kind of this rock rap fusion. And I think with, you know, Pharaoh Monch sort of being this very traditional kind of lyricist, hip hop lyricism, but I think this shows off his versatility and the fact that he grew up saying, you know, he listened to everything from Led Zeppelin and Black Sabbath, just as much as he listened to the Jacksons and listened to, you know, Old Soul and Gladys Knight and that kind of stuff. So anyway, so with that being said, let me pass it off to you guys and Artemis, drop all your personal notes, what you got here.
Drop all my personal notes. Well, first of all, I was amped that this album came out. I think, McCart Alive, a Facebook Live where Prince Poe was talking about it a little bit. And I kind of wish Prince Poe was on this album. We could have got like a Organized Confusion like collab with this, but it just didn't happen. I think they're working on something new. I'm not sure what's going on. But shouts to Poto, shouts to Munch, especially on this album. Yes, I definitely disagree with the Pitchfork review, but we'll get into that. We'll save that for a little bit later. I enjoyed this album. I'm always going to enjoy Munch's albums. Like he'll take his time with an album, develop it. He puts it together a certain way, and then he gives it to you. And there's always a very good political element that he layers in a lot of his music. And then he does something that I've been influenced by a lot. It's like the psychology of what he's doing in the music, and that's always helped me gain some perspective as an artist. Like, dang, I could take it this way if I wanted to, or go that way. And Munch is just he's a genius to me, you know. And I enjoyed this album. That's all I'm gonna say, for real. I really like the song "Racist," which I think we are getting into a little bit later. I was amped when I heard Cypress Hill was on the album. Like when that video dropped, I was like, "What?" And the backup vocals from Cinder. Oh my god, yeah. So.
Strong imagery, and definitely, yes. Like I said, very political.
Oh my god, so good. But yeah, that's my take on it. I like the album.
Big guitars, you know that I'm here for that. You know that I am here for that. I like the stripped down trio, kind of White Stripes-ish. Forget the bass, just turn up the guitar even louder and play the drums really, really loud, and like just have that be the music. I dig that. This album I totally dug too. I'm with you guys. The Pitchfork review, they gave him a 5.9, and you know, that's I think way low for the quality of lyricism here, the quality of music. Marcus Machado is like a beast on the guitar, and I love hearing all that guy's stuff. You know, we're going to talk a few of the songs, but a couple of songs we don't get a chance to talk about. We're not going to get a chance to talk about tonight. Goat's Head, I loved. Ooh, Scarecrow, cool. I loved. Kill 'Em All Again. Kill, kill, kill. Like it's all, it's a great, you know, drop the needle on side one, track one, and let it ride. I didn't really find too many points where I dozed off. I felt very in tune with what was going on lyrically and musically listening to this record. So why don't we jump into some of these jams here? The first song that we're going to talk about, Magician, who's got notes on this one?
Well, I do.
All right.
I think, okay. So for me specifically, talking about Magician, I think you really have to, I consider very much Munch to be a magician in some ways. So I think this song in particular is kind of the sadomasochist, or kind of this intense sort of fast-paced rhyme that he's really known as, and sort of this abrasive instrumental. School shootings. I mean, this is, you know, talking about from the experience of a high school kid who's experiences bullying and taking on the role and personifying this kid in the second verse, sure. And then kind of, you know, consumed with anger, who then becomes, you know, violent as a result. And you kind of, it humanizes, I think, this particular, the school shooter, which, you know, we never really hear from that perspective, and what is their journey into, you know, you don't just become or just aren't born a school shooter. There is some catalyst. And so anyway, this song, The Magician, kind of, I feel like this is really magically delivering words and a magical instrumental in many ways on a topic that's very hard to do.
Yeah.
Let's hear it.
Picture the past of his past, the vast fatal mask, smash the Renaskus in a rat and chastise for bad. Who often laughed at him, neglected his ass against his blockings, and they captured him away.
He was never respected them, and he never played soccer. He never mastered your master class. So they teased and they mocked him. The fucking bastard, they whipped his ass. And he weaved and they robbed him behind the school. He even late for a day. But the masquerade is over now. I got something to say. Let's see who listens. I've got a good. With ammunition, my magic trick comes to fruition. You disappear from the magician. I've got something to say. Let's see who listens. I've got a gun with ammunition. My magic trick comes to fruition. You disappear from the magician. Nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. I'm gonna get you, voodoo magic. I'm the magician. I'm the magician.
What?
Man. Yeah. Hard solid, topic. Solid, like, solid. I don't know. That's why I'm like musician. Because how many people can cover a topic like that from both sides? And
right.
You know, and then, yeah.
He's always been the good. He's always been the, I don't want to say the king of conceptually putting together a whole song that's a metaphor, but he's so good at it. Mm-hmm. And it's this, it's one of those songs where you forget that Pharoah Monch can get into this world where you hear his voice, not just only rapping, because that's like the, that's like his skill set at the forefront. You forget that he can sing low key, like Lenny Kravitz kind of sing, and just like kind of like get into this this world of just like riding with the beat. And I don't know why this this makes me think of from his from one of his older albums when he had the song Hitman, which was like so fire. And it had that, I feel like those songs like that were his precursor to get into this bag here, and where he's like really just going all out with a nice like rock band. So yeah, I love this track.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great, great track. The music just hits you, you know, kind of right between the eyes. And yeah, I do enjoy, lyricism that tells stories, and so, you know, whether it's first person, third person, this song is taking you on a journey, and it's classic storytelling, you know, from a lyrical perspective. But yeah, the music is just like, it's really, really tight. You're right, Artemis, he's a low-key really good singer. So yeah, just great track. I mean, I think you guys hit all the high notes on this one. High notes, so to speak.
Ah, we see what you did there. Your drumsticks. Yeah. Where are your drumsticks? Like,
I got them right here. I'll bust them out.
Never mind. Leave them there. Never mind.
Why don't we move on to the next jam that we're going to talk about on this one? Which is a song called Racist. Let's hear this one and we'll talk about it on the other side.
If you can find anyone who slept on sick vines in my post 2009, they will unequivocally be wearing the same suit since that year. Surrounded by six sides of pine, they say I'm preaching my songs, but this is not me teaching from song. This is a move of the day of the Geechee is gone, and there's no need to discuss or debate shit.
Yes.
Melodies Palestinian and the snares spick. The rhythm is Dominican, I use a kite as a kick. Crumble crags in the track in the same place that you can sit. Spin on a white mic, separated in the mix. And in the end, the concept was there before I made it. Perceived it, stole it, claimed it, raped it. They begged me for royalties, but I laughed and leave them hanging like a stupid nigga for singing these ignorant choruses that they be making. If the bass is Jamaican, I get specific with the hi-hats that are Haitian. Let the Asians do the arithmetic. Tick, 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 tick.
Come on, man. Let me say this off the break. So if you're familiar with Organized Confusion, you're going to know that they've had songs that go into this realm and take you down a path of just like social commentary. If you ever get a chance, check out this album, The Equinox, which was the third Organized Confusion album. And they have a song called Hate on it that Prince Poe actually got Rhyme of the Month one time in the Source War. Hate breaks down racism so well. Like, it's such a dope song. I feel like this is like a, I don't want to say this is completely an updated version of it, but it's like such a good, such a good presentation of it now. Like, he takes the notion and the concept of it and he flips it and makes it something else with 13. So yeah, I like this track a lot.
I was going to say, I like this track too a lot. I think one of the most exciting things about it, I love Lee Stone. Lee Stone had a large hand in Internal Affairs, which was Pharoah Monch's debut solo album. But I think that album, Lee Stone was like the executive producer, co-executive producer, I mean, engineer, like really, and I got a chance to talk to him, and is really a rock, like, I mean, totally a rock nerd and metal, death metal nerd. And so the fact that, like, I always think his drums are very pronounced, and like the way that he makes a track, it is very thoughtful, and the way that this beat kind of like crescendos, I feel like kind of the drums come in and then kind of go out and then, you know, really come and pronounce. I love everything about this track. So that was just Artemis. I think you're spot on, and like, this is Pharoah Monch's, like, to me, lyrical space of being able to explain concepts like that in a way that is really, at the same time, kind of interesting and like melodic. You know, he can do that and it not be like over your head, but yet somehow, you know, when people say, oh, people use big words, like, he doesn't really have to do that. The concepts of, though, are always really thoughtful and strategic, and the bars are really layered. So this song that I love.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm hard pressed to add much to that. I think both of you guys hit it. It's such interesting lyricism, the kind of stuff that makes people think. I think is intended to make people think, but, you know, not everybody thinks and is self-reflective. But, you know, musically, again, big guitars, big drums, and big lyrics. So yeah, I really dug this song too. Let's jump into our last song that we're gonna dig into on this album, a song called The Exorcist. Let's hit it.
I survived the forgotten evil incarnate you would hardly believe in. Sipping whiskey from a goblet with a handful of snakes. Penetrating Medusa like a dog for the obvious reasons. She's screaming all the way to the morgue, releasing goblins and demons. 13. I mean, it's obvious some godly squeezing on powerful scenes. Scheming on the ivory tower when they're cowardly heathens. While I sit on a throne made of skeletons vomiting credence. The verses will curse you for treason. I'm easily the freest deity to solve the misleading of a diseased generation that participates in their grievance. And it's an epidemic of epic proportion, derived from weaponized mechanisms, lies and distortion. I sacrificed the pig's heart and wrapped it in frog skin. For nepotism, the rise of the four horsemen, I'll devise an exorcism and exercise of abortion.
Wow.
Yes.
Spice. That man is a surgeon. That man is a surgeon with the bars.
Yeah, he is.
Like, the imagery and just the bounce. Like, it's kind of crazy when you hear tracks like this put together where you could almost hear like the pre-production element of it and then the live band element added in with it. Like, they made sure to make it like a very good mix of like hip hop and rock. So it doesn't sound corny, you know what I'm saying? And
I
heard that song. I was like, yeah, what? Like, I've gotten used to Pharoah Monch rapping for years, but the fact that he did it like this was like, yo, nuts.
Yeah, crazy. I think sign of a good MC is being able to flow over a lot of different styles and a lot of different types of music. So it was great to hear Pharoah Monch over this type of like just heavy kind of 70s era riff rock, And so, yeah, I mean, his lyrics are just crazy, crazy good on this song, on this whole record. I don't know, Tia, should we talk about the Pitchfork and review and shit on those guys a little bit?
I mean, Artemis brought some of that up. I just will say this song, like, it was one of the ones they dissed. They didn't like the recording, the sound of it. I'm like, Super Ugly is not really, like, to me, like a modern day producer, which makes it kind of cool, because this is somebody who, you know, did Onyx. So, you know, and if you think about, like, this is kind of in the realm of that. Onyx was really great, I think, at merging sort of those different genres together, especially with different, they have a lot of rock influence and the moshing and you know, just the way that they actually performed and some of their music. And also, you know, this is a person who worked with De La Roca, you know, I mean, if you work with Zach De La Roca, I mean, there's just, like, I can say nothing bad about you as a producer, first of all. But I think, you know, right, just the soundscapes that were, like, Pharrell picked smart producers too for these tracks. So it wasn't just, like, kind of like willy-nilly out of the blue. It was, like, really pensive about who was included and how they, you know, people that really developed this, I think, marriage of rock and hip hop really well. So I, you know, Pitchfork, just, I feel like, missed the mark. And I honestly feel like when people are listening and they're trying to get, like, they want sort of this predictable, you know, mantra. And I feel like people saying, like, oh, you know, I don't want to hear him croon or, like, sing. I don't want to hear that. They want to hear, you know, this amazing, like I said, lyrical dexterity that he's known for, which I thought he gave all of that. But there's also sort of this, you know, kind of really, I feel like the instrumentals kind of complement that. And that's what was not liked as much. They felt like they were unfurbished. And there was even a comment about saying they were repetitive and cliched, like the sound, some of the riffs and stuff. Yeah. And I'm like, I feel like, I mean, unfortunately, when you mix rap and rock, like, things have to kind of be a little bit, like, looped, you know what I mean? Like, you kind of have to have that sound. So anyway, I didn't get it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the review, just a couple of quick lines from the review. This is a quote: "The musicians thrash out blood raw rock instrumentals for Munch, taking up the role of frontman to rap, singing, croon over. Promotional material connected to the record even shows the 48-year-old with an overgrown beard, kitted out in leather jacket and bandana. It's all a bit, kids, your father is in the basement jamming with his friends." Like, that's kind of shitting on
that's God. Harsh.
And he's a brilliant MC. Hasn't had a record since 2014. And I think it's because he cares about crafting the art that he wants to make. And I think reviewers sometimes fall into the trap of wanting a record or a project to be something, and it's not that. And you kind of have to take the project for what it is. This very clearly was a sort of Jack White, White Stripes, rapping over, like, just heavy raw rock. You know, I mean, I'm sure Machado's playing a Les Paul through a Marshall stack to get those big, big, big guitar sounds. You know, I mean, you have to kind of take the project for what it is. And I felt like Pitchfork, our reviewer, and I actually should probably say what his name is if we can. Yeah. Dean Van Wyn. And not to shit on the guy, just to say that I think we disagree. I think each of us, we appreciate the artistry on this album for what it is. And it is Pharrell Munch delivering, I think, like, a lyrical tour de force. He's obviously very angry, as a lot of people are, at the closed tail end, ass end of the Trump era. You know, there's a lot of, like, anger and bitterness and rawness at looking around at, you know, what our society's become. And I definitely felt that come through, you know, powerfully, like, you know, right between the eyes.
Exactly. Now, that reviewer's name, again, that's Dean Van Nguyen. That's D-E-A-N-V-A-N-G-Y-E-N. if you ever see him review some more shit, might have to review his review, since he's out here giving out album soft 0.9s. He gets a 0 point fuck you, you know what I'm saying? It's one of those. And furthermore, I was more so pissed off.
Don't at this man.
Wait for it. I was more so pissed off about this other comment he made. This motherfucker had the nerve to say the 13 sound lands somewhere between Sabbath-esque metal, Onyx's hard moshing hardcore hip hop, and Kid Rock. What?
Kid Rock.
No, wait. Sabbath, I'm okay with. Of course, Onyx is doing anything. Kid Rock is trash. Complete fucking trash. He's always copied Run DMC. Does Pharoah Monch sound like fucking Run DMC when he raps? No. And this kid, like, he obviously did his research on who Organized Confusion was, but he didn't listen to the goddamn albums. Does he even know what the fuck Fudge Pudge was? No. I'm pretty sure he heard Stress once fucking French Montana sampled it for one of his singles. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Come on, man.
You're insulted by that. I am too. I think that I looked at this gentleman's reviews or whomever, this person's reviews, right? And I saw that they review like Action Bronson's newest and gave that like a 6.7, and King Von's newest gave that like a 7 point something. Like they're an interesting reviewer. I don't know, but I think one of the things that got me said that I'm not really familiar with Monch, because it was like the saving grace is Monch's performance. His flow naturally funky and with a light lisp reminiscent of Kool G Rap still embodies classic New York street rap cool. And I just thought, like, I mean, first of all, they're contemporaries, so it's really annoying. And then to say that he sparked thoughts of Aesop Rock is like, you know, Aesop Rock is not everybody's, like, you know, I don't know, White Rabbit or whatever. Like, that's just not it for everybody. I love Ace, but at the same time, like, give Pharoah his flowers. 30 years, bro. Like, you need to get up on it.
Get that kid the fuck out of here. You can't be saying Pharoah Monch sounds like Kool G Rap, dickhead. And don't even try to say that he's trying to sound like Aesop Rock. Aesop Rock came up in the indie era when it was late 90s and the 2000s. Are you fucking stupid? Don't do that shit. Get him the fuck out of here. Stick a fork in him, pitchfork, and he's done. That's all I got to say about it, man. That shit was irritating.
Wow, that took a turn. Wow. Sorry. That took a turn there. All right. I'm glad. You know what? Grande Loq, the grandiloquent hip hop show. You know, we got space for everybody to release whatever it is they gotta release, man. I appreciate you. All right. Yeah, we're gonna come back and we're going to talk about Dre Day.
Yeah.
Hello.
What's up?
Nothing. What you doing?
Man, I'm just kicking it.
Are y'all good? Thank
you. Nah, what you going to do today?
I ain't going to get my nails done. Yeah. Why, what's up?
Hey, did what's your name get at you yesterday?
These nuts. Oh, shut up,
nigga. But I want to ask you one question. If I had some nuts hanging on the wall, what would I have, honey? I'm just, darling, you have some walnuts. She said, well, daddy, if I had some nuts on my chest, would those be chestnuts? I said, hell yeah. She said, well, if I had nuts under my chin, would those be chin nuts? I said, hell no, bitch, you'd have a dick in your mouth.
Taking it back.
Oh, wow. Yes. That was These Nuts from Dr. Dre's The Chronic. This was my choice, my selection for a classic this week. Look, this was every white kid's favorite hip hop record for like anywhere between like 92 and 95. It certainly was mine and all of my buddies. I just remember being at a lot of parties. This was always going doggy style, some kind of Public Enemy, P PM Dawn. I mean, like all kinds of crazy shit. And so this album always takes me back. It's one of my favorite hip hop records. The great, great Dr. Dre. You know, it always felt dangerous to be like a white kid from the Midwest listening to Dr. Dre or listening to NWA. And so I think that was a big part of the allure to a very young and awkward semi-marginal musician. So, yeah, I mean, Tia, I know you said you got a lot of history with this record.
Yes. So, I mean, first of all, this is to me probably arguably one of the top three most important albums in hip hop history. Like every seminal like group has a watershed album or whatever that just like launched, you know, superstar careers of like guest stars and stuff. I mean, there's so many that are there, but like, I don't think any more than The Chronic. Like to me, it's just like, and you know, the fact that it just entered the like streaming world like last year on 420, I think is also like, I mean, this album has sold 6 million copies in the US. Like it's one of those albums like everybody in the world has, but I think my personal relationship with it was that it was one of the first albums that I guess sort of started my hip hop journey with, because I took and wrote down all the lyrics, you know, in that day and time is kind of how you learned them really quickly, was like you wrote everything down. And like, you know, my cousin said, write every single thing down, you know, every time they take a breath, write breath in parentheses. When there's a or an ad lib, like what ad lib is, you know, he explained that to me. When somebody says, yeah, or like, man, or whatever, like write that in parentheses, you know. So everything I did, right, like I wrote it in parentheses. And to me, it's just like, this is just, there is no better, I think I've seen that, no better produced album. I mean, this album set the producer kind of quality up, because it's not only just really well produced, but also engineered and like mixed well. And like, that's, you know, Dre was just really known for perfection and perfectionism. So, you know, this to me is like, it's like everything is like a Marvel movie, and it's like superheroes in this album. And like, everybody is, you know, it's just one-ups from Lady of Rage. I mean, who's one of my favorites, that's inspired me. But like, you know, even like Jewel, who's a very little known singer, but Nate Dogg, right? Like this launched the career of Nate Dogg. And like,
yeah.
So, and Snoop, of course, I mean, how could we even not say Snoop Corrupt? But I mean, just like, to me, like these, Nate Dogg's relationship, even with this album and like, becoming known for, like, it's now like a verb, like you Nate Dogged that, you know what I mean? Like, so I just, this album, man, there's just very little things that you can say for, like, aside from like, I feel like DLC should get a lot of credit from this album too, because I know he wrote a lot of these songs.
Later on
we found out, but like, I mean, just superhero stuff.
Yeah, if Dre is Captain America, I think Snoop is Iron Man on this one. Yeah. Artemis, what are your overall thoughts on The Chronic?
That was my shit. That skit. I always love that skit. But I actually have some interesting memories of this, because when you brought this album up, I was like, yo, I knew a lot of people that had this album, and I didn't have to actually buy the album, because I would listen to it. I didn't listen to it so much, but I listened to it enough. I was like, oh, damn, this is dope. Now, I have like Rap City memories with this album, which I didn't tell y'all. So the video for Nothing But G Thing, it just came on. Everybody was always watching it. Like all their videos got so much play. You were just like, yo, you were glued to it. It didn't even matter if you watched it 10 times. You were going to watch it again. And then, you know, at school the next day, we're all trying to wear our khakis, like Snoop and Dre, like trying to like get Chucks. Like we were just influenced by that album and what had happened. And I feel like for my generation, if you weren't really hip to NWA like that, you got hip to this album somehow. It was weird, because that actually happened to me. I had to go back and listen to NWA, even though like my sister had a tape of it, and I checked it out a little bit. This album actually was like, oh, this is who Dr. Dre is. Okay. This is like, I was like, I had no idea. So classic album. I think it's a. I would say this has to be a top 10 must have at this point. Top 10, sure. Top 20. One of those. It's up there. So yeah, man. God, we're looking at this album.
This is one of these albums that I can tell has been a part of my life because I think I've literally owned like 6 copies of it, like at least 5 of them on CD. And it's just like, I lost it in this move, or this girl broke up with me and I never got my Dre off. I never got my Chronic back. It was just listening to it in the car, listening to it, hearing these songs in clubs, hearing them at parties when I was in college. It was quintessential. To me, it's a quintessential LA hip hop sound from the 90s. This is sort of the sound that sparked Doggy Style and sparked Tupac and just elemental. So let's jump into these jams because this is going to be fun. First tune we're gonna talk about is "Fuck with Dre Day," so let's kick it.
Yeah, hold on.
So great.
Let me get it right. Let me dive in. So that part where "Fuck with me," it's a must have "Fuck with you." The video where it used to cut, and it went to that office. Easy walks in. And somebody's trying to be like Jerry Heller, whatever. And they that used to trip me out. I used to like wait for that part to come on. I'm like, oh, my part's coming up. Hold on. And the song just stops and it goes to that skit. I used to love that. But it threw me off though, because I listened to that version so much of the video that when this version would come on, the curse words would throw me off. I was like, oh, he did say it this way. He didn't say it that way. Yeah. This song was a trip, man. Like, it was, I was surprised it got as much play as like Nothing But G Thing at one point, but they stopped playing it as much though. So it's dope. It's a dope cut.
You know, I have not a lot to add to that other than the fact that, like, listen, I was an Eazy-E stan because, you know, like, I mean, it was just, stan. And I look, and real MFNGs are still like, I still play it pretty much monthly. Ask anybody who knows me. Naturally, I plays Eazy-E on a monthly basis. Just like, it's a requirement for my life. You know, it's part of my therapy. But "Fuck with Dre Day," right? Like, I mean, this production, like Funkadelic's "Not Just Me Deep" is like the perfect song to use for this. Yeah. This is where, you know, Dre. I don't know if before the Chronic, if people paid attention to production as much as the Chronic. Like, this was an album where it came and you said the beats have like our main course. They're not where before I think it's sort of like the focus is on the lyrics and the artistry and the whole cohesive package. It's like beats first, everything else comes in as this beautiful like appetizer on top of it. Like he's really cooking a meal with this shit. And like, I mean, you know, Tim Dog, like, you want to say something, I got something for your ass. Luke Campbell, I got something for your ass, okay? Ice Cube, you too. You want to do not know Vaseline, that's cute. Okay, I got something for your ass. He went, like, everybody, they just went right at it. And the video, I mean, come on, the video is classic. And it's like, I feel like that video inspired Cube in many ways to kind of like Friday, some of the personalities that he like cast and stuff like that, like, came from the video. So you know what I mean, like, it's just funny now to think about, like, I don't know how it all came together and like how it all worked. And like, I mean, just again, the guitar, like Dre was also a genius of like adding live music and like music, and so adding guitar and Rhodes and strings to this record, which is already really heavily like musical kind of, you know, Funkadelic record, like, it's just, yeah, I could go on all day. Ian, please take it away. I can't.
No, this is great. I knew this was going to spark great, great conversations. I mean, look, you can't escape the fact it's an early 90s hip hop record. It's a West Coast hip hop record. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of misogyny. There's a lot of homophobia. There's a lot of like violence and threats of violence and all that stuff, but it is like just like a distillation of like some of the really, really classic many of the classic hip hop tropes that we just take for granted now these days, you know, this was foundational. This was, you know, how those things became tropes. And, you know, a lot of people tried to out Dre and out Snoop. And it's just there's no getting past that. There's no getting past that.
I feel, I mean, cut you off, but I feel like there's, didn't like Luke have a response to this video or something?
Yeah. I mean,
I could have sworn.
He tried because he had already dissed them. And so this was, you know, I guess Dre's attempt to say, hold on, like before you, like, don't ever try to diss me, you know? And I think at the same time, like, there's so much comedy, like Ian, you talk about the tropes, like he brought out the fact that kind of hip hop, you know, the whole personality thing is kind of comedy, like just as much as it can be like hardcore and like, you know, Dre brought out, there's a lot of comedy in that, like, how hardcore are you? You know what I mean? Like there's a lot of funny stuff that's just like, Luke, you're funny, you know?
Yeah, that's crazy.
You get past those kinds of things, so, yeah.
Hey, low-key, low-key, Luke's video was kind of roasting him, though. I can't even lie. That video was kind of, she was kind of funny. Like, he was making fun of him with the leaf behind his head.
Yeah.
And I think there were a couple of other people. I feel like, nah, man, I want to say BG Knockout had something. I don't remember. It was a lot of videos going back and forth. I remember that.
I'm sure a lot of people who got roasted on the Chronic decided they needed to go back. Mm. The problem is you got roasted on the Chronic, which is a top
me,
five.
You know, they got hip-hop. Roasted so bad. It's like Ice Cube. He got roasted so bad on Fuck With Dre Day that he came and was in the video for Let Me Ride.
Damn right, it was a good day.
Check this out.
That's how you get them. Like, that's how you get a person.
Yep.
Speaking of which.
Exactly right. Speaking of which, let's jump to the next one that we're going to talk, which is the next song on the record. You've heard this one. You've grooved to this one. You know it. Let Me Ride.
Long time I watch you, I want to chat to you. I go on like you don't want to chat to me. So what I'm doing, tell you what the fuck I'm going on.
Creeping down the back street on D's. I got my Glock cocked, cause niggas want these. No sooner as I said it, seems I got sweated by some nigga with a Tech 9 trying to take mine. You wanna make noise, make noise. I make a phone call, my niggas coming like the Gotti boys. Bodies being filed on Greenleaf with the fucking heads cut off. Motherfucker, I'm Dre. So listen to the play-by-play, day-by-day. Rolling in my phone with 16 switches. And got sounds for the bitches, cocking all the riches. Hollow points for the snitches, so won't you just walk on by, cause I'm too hard to lift, and no, this ain't Aerosmith, it's the motherfucking DRE, from the CPT, on a riding spree, a straight G, hop back as I pop my top, you trip, I let the hollow points commence to pop, 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 yeah, cause if it don't stop, I have to put my shit in reverse, go back and
oh,
cause I'm rolling in my 6'4".
Motherfucker, I'm Dre. I love that. Oh my god. Oh my god. I gotta just, you know, a little peek behind the curtain of Grande Loq, the Grandiloquent hip hop show. So I'm out running errands today, listening to this album, just kind of like trying to get myself back in the headspace. I know I'm gonna be talking about it tonight. Mm-hmm. And I get out of the car and I look across the parking lot and I see this Toyota with a license plate, Virginia license plate, 3 D's. And I took a picture and I sent it to these guys. And of course, Artemis is like, man, why you gotta send this shit to me? I don't want to see this. 3 D's? What, he got 3 testicles? I'm just like, oh my god.
I just asked what it was supposed to mean. I was like, he was like, it's Dre Day. I'm like, that makes no sense. There's like three, there's no 3Ds in Dre Day. Like, I don't, what? Yeah, it's like 3 balls. Like, that's what you made it sound like. I'm like, why would you want to show me that? Like,
I felt like that was the universe reaching down and shaking my hand and saying, yes, sir, you should talk about Dr. Dre tonight. And so I had to share that. I had to share that with y'all. 3 Ds. So I don't mean to I don't mean to put any a Northern Virginia driver on the spot. If you listen to Grande Loq, the Grandiloquent hip hop show, and you are the owner and driver of said Toyota, license plate Virginia 3Ds, by all means, hit us up on Twitter. We'll hit Artemis and Tia up on Twitter. Don't follow me. Artemis up on TikTok. Like his videos because he's gonna dance for you guys.
I'm not dancing for shit and hit up 3Ds. That sounds like a bad report card. I don't know what's going on.
3Ds, yeah. 3Ds. That sounds like my sixth grade.
3Ds. And I don't know what's going on.
Okay, all right. Let me ride. That bass, that's quintessential. I love the little flute working in the back. But that bass drives that jam, and that is like, that's head nod hip hop right there, man. That's just rolling in my 6'4". Yeah, you know.
Yes.
That bass line, it catches me every time. I know, Tia, I know you got some background information on this, but like, for me personally, it's like I put it up there with like when I hear like some stuff from Pete Rock, of course, or you know, even our homie Kev Brown when he has those like bass lines in the production to just hit, you know. And it's just, it's like every time I listen to that beat, I was like, man, I got freestyle over this. Like, this is, it's dope. I mean, I remember like Dre's verses and like the way he was rapping over it was crazy. But yeah, that song, come on, man. That song is just so fire. Ain't much else to say. It's just that fire, man.
You know, there, yeah. I mean, what can you say in that case? It's sort of like, I think the bass was Mike Elizondo, who was like known as to be, he played multiple instruments for Dre throughout like his life, won tons of Grammys working with sort of a Dre protege and played on so many albums, but of course we know him much for contributing a lot of the bass lines on top of that. And I mean, how could you like, again, another like great Parliament, like just sample, like, I mean, you know, I don't really think there's too much like you can say bad about this. Like, I would love to hear the Pitchfork reviewer that reviewed this in that day. Like, what did they say about this? Because like Mothership Connection, shut your ass up. Like, that's one of the greatest songs ever. And this is just showcases that. George Clinton is on, like, additional vocals on there from him. I mean, this song off the album won a Grammy, you know? So it's like Dre won his first Grammy with this song. So it was just like, you know, I don't know. This Let Me Ride is just a classic. It's just no, I one time was looking on YouTube for like people making it over. And like you see, you know, it's great to see like people from all over the world. Like I have seen, you know, like Japanese kids rapping these lyrics. I mean, but they know it's spot. How could you not? Like Dre, they don't mess up one beat. And I remember sending this one kid or whatever to like to Arnell. Arnell's laughing. He's like, that kid is like, he is like, fuck with Dre if you want to. Like he will kill somebody over Dre, the way that he's rapping. So, I mean, people just look, they get personal when it comes to Let Me Ride. Like they don't play. They know it, and that's a favorite for a lot of people.
Yeah. I made the point earlier that how kind of quintessential 90s West Coast hip hop this album is, and sort of like the sound I feel that this album had a hand in sparking. I mean, even as recently as like 2015, you know, Kendrick Lamar's To Pimp a Butterfly, there's so many little beats from this album that make it all the way, you know, almost 30 years later, into, you know, the next generation of Compton hip hop. I mean, you had George Clinton at the beginning of that album. I mean, Pimp a Butterfly is one of my absolute very favorite hip hop records. Yeah. And I feel like it was in many ways a modern retelling, musically, maybe not lyrically, but musically, of what's going on in this album. Just great stuff. Let's get into our last cut here. This is Nothing But a G Thing.
One, two, three. bringing to the folks. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the door, ready to make an entrance, so back on up,
cause you know we're about to rip shit up.
Give me the microphone first so I can bust like a bubble. Compton and Long Beach together, now you know you in trouble. Ain't nothing but a G-Bang, baby. Too low, death niggas, so we're crazy. Death Row is the label that pays me. Unfadable, so please don't try to fake this. But back to the lecture at hand. Perfection is perfected, so I'ma let them understand from a young G's perspective. And before me dig out a bitch, I have to find a contraceptive. You never know, she could be earning her man and learning her man, and at the same time burning her man. Now you know I ain't with that shit, Lieutenant. Ain't no pussy good enough to get burned while I'm offended. And that's realer than real deal, holy feel. And now you hookers and hoes know how I feel. Well, if it's good enough to get rough off a proper chunk, I take a small piece of some of that funky stuff. It's like this and like that and like this and up. It's like that and like this and like that and up. It's like this and like that and like this and up. Drake creep to the mic like a fan.
Well, I'm beeping and I'm creeping and I'm,
and I'm creeping. And then yeah. Your cap, because my beeper kept beeping. Yeah.
One, two, three, and to the four.
So, that's Ian, you said, you know, this is quite the essential album for white kids to listen to.
Yeah.
Look, I was little brothers and sisters back in the day. We was bumping this shit, too. Like
I know.
It was a universal album. And this song made it so universal. Like, you know, you never heard something so smooth, so cool, and it was, like, gangster at the same time. It made you want to be like them, you know?
Yeah.
You know, so it's like, you've memorized the verses. Like, this was the one song that the DJ spun. And when it came on, everybody's like, oh, shit, like, dancing. You're pretending that you got Cold 45 in your hand, and you're trying not to scream. Like, that's how fire it was when it came out. We used to, like, man, I used to try to remember all the parts of this song, too, like, trying to get down, like, the styles and patterns. I was like, yo, this is fire.
I'll tell you what, man. You have not lived until you have been in the sweaty, hot basement of like some ancient fraternity house at insert college here, with a bunch of white kids drunk on beer from a keg that somebody's like in the corner pumping, and when this album comes on. Like half the white kids in the room will rap the entire album, and I'm not gonna let you know if I was one of those kids
who could rap the
entire album. Let's just say I don't have bars.
But I'm scared.
But I can mimic a little.
That Let Me Ride will get you right there.
Oh yeah,
boom. Right there. I didn't write them all down. I didn't write them all down with like paren breath, but.
Let me fret.
This is like, you can't even, this song, well, I feel like this song for me, when you talk about like, just, again, we early started this conversation about sampling. Like, I don't know if like, there is a more notable use of Leon Haywood, I Want to Do Something Freaky to You. So I just had my friend Double Schizo, shout out to him, just flip the sample. And like somebody messaged me who knows me and knows him and said, oh my God, look what he did to the sample. Because it was so different and so weird what he sampled out of that song. That's so anti anything that, you know, is close to this, I think, right? Like, because if you are even in the vein of like that refrain, of anything around Nothing But a G Thing, like you can't use that sample. Like that puts you in the, unless your song is something that is a reference or connected to this song, you can't just leave this, you know, I Want to Do Something Freaky to You sample alone. Because I think it is just notable. It's very hard unless you are, you know, expert level at it. And I think like thinking about like Dre, you know, and again, what makes I think this album really distinctive is his use of like the Moog and like being so prominent on the Chronic, and like this song particularly by adding like, you know, he's like, look, I just wanted to, you know, be able to use this, you know, this Leon Haywood sample that actually I never knew Warren G actually had. So like this was a Warren G thing, and then, you know, kind of Snoop stole it. Sort of like he was in jail and like was like, I wrote this song, and Dre was like, that is the song I want to, you know, the lyrics and the rhyme, I want to be on this song. So you just think about the fact of like adding an 808 and like the synth, the little string part and live bass, and like this song becomes a classic, but again, based off of a very notable sample that's been probably sampled a million times, but none like the way Dre did it.
Exactly.
That bass line again, just like elemental, quintessential. So yeah, I would say, what do we got? 3 thumbs up on this album. if you're a real old head, if you've made it this far into episode 10 or 11 or 12 of yes. Grande Loq, and you have not spent time with Dr. Dre's The Chronic, 1, you need to change that, and 2, you know,
get into it.
All right, guys. Well, I think that's going to wrap it up for us tonight. This was Grande Loq, the Grandiloquent Hip Hop Show. Tia Artemis, amazing stuff as always.
Yep.
Great to be with you as always. This is Grande Loq, and if you enjoyed it, we would be honored if you would rate, review, subscribe, tell your friends about us. You know, we're on YouTube and Facebook, and you can search Grande Loq with a Q. Production is courtesy of the great Marcus Donovan, the pasteurized chef. You can check out his show, The District of Misfits Show, every other Sunday evening. They go live at 9, and it's a super fun, super loose time. This show is a District Dogface Studios production. Big shout out to AOC, Sigue la Lucha. Thank you for letting us into your brain. Peace.
Peace.
Peace.